Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. It's me, Swastika, and in case you haven't subscribed already, please don't forget to press the red button at the bottom of the video screen. So as I've already stated, in this video we would be discussing the world system analysis. But before I get into the detail and into the academic portion of what exactly it is, I would just simply like to explain it in simple words. A lot of you may have seen the movie called The Hunger Games. If you haven't, I strongly suggest that you do see it. And in that movie, there is this main character, she's Katniss, and the entire story sort of revolves around her survival. So there is a capital and there are districts. The capital would probably be here and the 12 districts would probably be there. So what happens in that movie essentially is that the capital is one of the richest areas. It's the richest portion of that entire nation because everything that the capital has, all the resources that they have, come from peripheral and semi-peripheral districts like 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So what happens is that the further you move away from the center, that is the capital, and the more you move towards district number 12, the districts start getting poorer. In simple words, the capital is rich. The core is rich because they are exploiting poor people, because they are exploiting people from lesser known districts. And that, in simple words, is going to be the core, periphery, semi-periphery analysis, or simply the world system analysis that I am now going to discuss with you in this video.
Okay, so guys, before we begin, let me just tell you a little about myself. I have done my master's in political science from Jawaharlal Nehru, CPS. I have completed my BA honors in political science from Delhi University. And in case you like my content, please don't forget to subscribe. You can also comment your doubts down below in the comment section and I would most probably reply to all of them. So let's start off with understanding the world system analysis. So essentially, Emmanuel Wallerstein seeks to explain the capitalist world system as a total social system. And there have been some major contributions. Two of them are The Rise and the Future Demise of the World Capitalist System, Concepts for Comparative Analysis, 1974. And the second one is The Modern World System 1, Capitalist Agriculture and the Origins of the European World Economy in the 16th Century. So these are two major contributions that you have to keep in mind. So Emmanuel Wallerstein describes the world system as a social system that has boundaries, structures, member groups, rules of legitimation and coherence. It almost has the characteristics of an organism which views all unitary societies to be embedded in the world system and cannot be understood in isolation. In simple words, what he's trying to explain is that, for example, this is your system. This complete system is made up of unitary societies. These unitary societies cannot be understood in isolation, but we have to understand them to be embedded in a world system. He further goes on to explain that most nation states are part of the world system and thus cannot be understood in isolation. And these can be categorized into three parts. The first social system that he talks about would be a mini system comprising of self-contained homogeneous societies, which are basically pastoral and simple horticulture. So socio-economic units are capable of producing all goods and services within its socio-cultural system. The second social system he talks about is a world empire, which is based on the extraction of surplus goods and services from outlying areas, forced to incur heavy expenditures for strengthening of administrative and military apparatus, followed along with the political rulers as the heads of the empires. This is an empire. The third is world economies lacking both unified political system and its dominance based on military powers. So why was a modern system needed. The modern world is basically a consequence of feudal crisis. So the feudal society basically led to the explosion of commerce and population. To continue this sort of growth, geographical expansion was needed. This geographical expansion and the need for it eventually led to the creation of a new world. Empires depended on the states, and techniques of modern capitalism enabled the world to extend beyond political boundaries. So in this new international system, there were three categories. The first was core, the second was periphery, the third was semi-periphery, and lastly, it was external areas, which is basically considered external to the system. So the core was the most beneficiary of the regions. They were major beneficiaries from the capitalist world economy. It basically included states like England, France, and Holland. Politically, the states which were part of the region of Europe developed strong central relations. This well-ranging and well-maintained structure helped the local bourgeois to be able to obtain control over international commerce and made it possible to extract capital surplus. So basically what this core region did was that they used to get a lot of cheap material from the peripheral areas into for themselves. Then they used to manufacture and create goods out of this raw material and sell them to at very expensive prices to the peripheral and the semi-peripheral areas. So basically the core, by extraction and complete exploitation of the following two, which I'll just talk about, became rich. The core included areas like England, France, and Holland. The next we are going to talk about is what we mean by periphery. So mostly there on the other end lay the peripheral zones, which did not have the characteristic of a strong central government and which were mostly under the control of other states. So unlike the core, which had a strong central government, the periphery sort of lacked this and they were under the control of other states. As I've already stated, the periphery used to export raw materials to the core. The periphery would be exporting raw materials to the core at very cheap prices. So this area was constituted by Eastern Europe, especially Poland and Latin America. The next one that we are going to talk about is semi-periphery. Between the two ends of the pole, so we've already said that this is the core and this is the periphery, and they are basically two ends. In the middle of them lies the semi-periphery. They want to improve their relative position in the economic system of the world, or semi-peripheral countries or nations are either those who were the core and are now in decline, or they are peripheral countries who are wanting to improve their position and doing well. The best examples of illustrations of declining cores, which in course of time became semi-peripheries during the period, are Portugal and Spain. Some other semi-peripheries include Italy, southern Germany, southern France, so on and so forth. So the semi-peripheral countries also exploited the peripheral countries. Everyone exploited the peripheral countries. The core did it in a much more systematic manner, but the semi-peripheral countries also did it. It's almost, again, I would like to take the example of Hunger Games, because it was very clearly depicted there that the further you move from the core, the capital, the center, the poorer you get. You get poorer because all the raw materials are exported from cheap, from the poorest of countries. So, and that raw material, when it is manufactured, is sold at higher prices to the poorer countries. So this is how the logic of exploitation works. The logic of exploitation works by making the poor people poorer and by making the rich people richer. It is almost systemic in nature. It is planned, it is organized, and it's done very systematically to ensure that the disparities in wealth, that wealth inequality keeps increasing. The last one that I'm going to talk about is external areas. So these areas basically maintained their own economic systems and they remained outside the realm of the world capitalist economy. The easiest example and the most simply understood example of external area would probably be Russia. So they were just outside the system. They were not a part of this totally exploitive world system. I have tried to explain this in a easier manner with this diagram. So again, this is the core, this is the semi-periphery in blue, and in green it's the peripheral region. So the core dominates and exploits labor peripheral countries for labor and raw materials. Again, a lot of cheap labor and raw materials go from the periphery to the semi-peripheral and core countries, and then these core countries sell these raw materials by creating goods out of them by and induce large profits by creating consumption goods. So this basically leads to global inequality. So this is the Wallerstein's world system theory model. You just have to remember core, semi-periphery, periphery, and you have to remember that the logic of exploitation works in a very systemic manner to ensure that there are disparities in wealth which lead to global inequality, and this global inequality is very systematically planned, and this is how it is planned. So this is the reason why economic development varies across space. You can also read up on this, that if we try to study the history of the capitalist world system, it is divided into four stages. Stage 1 and 2, we can talk about that there was a rise of the modern world, and this new world included ideas and things like bureaucratization, homogenization of local population, expansion of armed forces, concept of absolutism, and diversified economic activities. The stages 3 and 4 talk about how there was emphasis on industrial capitalism rather than agricultural capitalism, and this was seen most prominently in terms of how European states participated in the active discovery of regions for the exploitation of new markets. So this is actually important because we see that when the Industrial Revolution came to England, England actively tried to look for resources and raw materials in poorer countries so that they could derive cheap labor and cheap raw materials to make themselves rich. Immersion of competitive systems. This can be seen in the example of how competitive world systems such as Indian Ocean system were immersed into the growing European world system. Asia and Africa entered the system in 19th century as peripheral zones. So the more nations such as Asia and Africa, when they entered into the system, they were ruthlessly and mercilessly exploited for creating additional surplus for the core regions. So this was purely an industrial growth concern, and the idea was to make sure that the core regions would clearly profit and clearly benefit. This, in fact, in 1700s led England to become Europe's leading industrial and agricultural producer. By 1900, we see a shift towards manufacturing in peripheral zones. So you can try to remember all that, but if I have to explain the world system analysis in two lines, I would say that it is the logic of exploitation through which the core and the semi-peripheral countries ruthlessly exploit peripheral countries for their profit, for their gain, thereby creating widespread economic disparity and wealth inequality. So the logic of exploitation is clearly and systematically defined, organized, committed for the benefit of one at the cost of another. So if you did understand this and if you did like this, don't forget to subscribe, and you can connect with me on Instagram. You can also ask your doubts down below. Thank you.